I know, he would be just fine, whoever.
Children of God, on this holiest of days, we gather together to proclaim again the great mystery of our faith. Christ has died.
Christ is risen.
Christ has died.
Christ is risen.
Christ has died.
Christ is risen.
Christ has died. Christ is risen. Christ will come again. We worship God singing Jesus Christ is risen today.
Thank you. presence in our lives with the words, the actions, and the harm we offer to others. Yet on this Easter, as on the first Easter, God heals us. God fills us with grace. God calls us by name. Let us come clean to our loving God, praying together.
We think the story is so old and ancient to God that we cannot hear the astonishing news of life replacing death. We are so afraid of our own shadows that we cannot see the divine light streaming all around us. Convinced that there is nothing beyond earthly life, we cannot sense the resurrection hope which is calling us by name. On this day of new wonders and everlasting grace, we rejoice that you have not forgotten us. May we revel in the ancient promises being proclaimed afresh this morning. May we turn with our questions, our doubts, and our hearts towards Jesus, the giver of grace, who pours resurrection love into us all.
Beloved, on this joyful Easter day, rejoice again in God's good news. Our sins are as gone as shadows in the noonday sun. In Jesus Christ, we are forgiven.
In Jesus Christ, we are forgiven. Hallelujah. Amen.
The peace of Christ be with you.
And also with you.
Will you please share God's peace with those around you? But I understand, I get it. But anyway, this looks very interesting, and if you're at all interested in it, I encourage you to look further. Please notice the announcements that are in the purple insert. The One Great Hour of Sharing is still being received today. Information on going to a soccer game, which sounds kind of fun also. So if you're interested in that, please do. Paul Winkler, do you want to say a word about this insert, please?
Yeah. Good morning.
Good morning.
What a beautiful Sunday. First off, I want to thank you for your generosity because of all the things we're doing here at church is because of you and your generosity. Now, with Easter here, summer's not far behind. So a lot of you will be leaving town. We want to make sure you keep up with your pledges. So if you can find this insert in the bulletin, I'll give you a minute to look for it. On one side it says ways to support First Presbyterian Church. These are all the different ways that you can continue your pledge even through the summer if you're not going to be able to be here. So take a look at that. You can do it online, you can do from a bank draft, you can use a credit card. So take a look at that so you can continue with your pledges. Now on the other side, and I don't know if you all know this, but we have more than one fund here at First Presbyterian Church. We have an operating, which your pledges go toward. So we have several other funds, and they're listed on this other side. The Generation Fund, and I believe our Confirmation Class use some of that to go to their retreat. So it does with youth. We have the Lloyd Fund, it helps with maintenance of the church. The Memorial Fund, the Music Fund, and the Global Mission Fund. So if you would like to help the church beyond your pledge, you can actually designate one of those funds for your generous gift. So keep that in mind as well. We're going to highlight each one of these different funds throughout the next several months to give you more information about it. But take this home and keep it so you know how to give to the church and also the different funds that we have here at church. Thank you.
Thank you, Paul. Are there other announcements that I may have missed? Anything for the good of the order, for the good of the body? If not, I believe our children have a special ministry for us.
Will the members of the children's choir come up?
Thank you.
other children would like to come forward for just a moment, we're going to have just a moment with all the children. Hey guys, it is so good to see you, everyone. Looking sharp today? Oh my. Good morning to all of you. That was very nice. Well, tell me again the name of that song that some of you just sang. Lord, I've lift your name on high. Exactly. Thank you very much. So, we know what today is, right? What today is Easter, and Easter is about what? Easter is about finding eggs. Easter is about Jesus rising from the dead. But you know what? That's really important, but that also means something very important. Let me explain that. I'll bet each one of you is loved. Do you think you're loved?
Yeah.
Yeah? Who loves you? Your mom and dad love you? Okay. How about grandparents, maybe? They love you?
Yes.
How about some other cousins? Yes. Do your cousins love you?
Yes.
And God loves us. God loves us. God loves us so much. God loves us so much that God raised Jesus from the dead to show us how much God loves us. That's what Easter is all about. Easter is all about God loves us so much that God raised Jesus from the dead. So, eggs are great. Did some of you take part in the Easter egg hunt earlier?
Yeah.
Yeah? Did you leave some eggs for me? Gee, you had an Easter egg hunt yesterday with a bunny? That's pretty cool. Well, I'm going to look around after worship today and see if you left any eggs. So if you did, they belong to me. I just want you to know that. Don't come looking for them. But you remember, this is what Easter is all about. Easter is about how much God loves us. So let's pray and thank God for loving us. Can you repeat after me? Okay, let's pray. Dear God. Thank you for loving us so much.
Thank you for loving us so much.
That you raised Jesus from the dead.
That you raised Jesus from the dead.
To love us forever.
To love us forever.
In his name we pray.
In his name we pray.
Amen.
Amen.
Thank you very much. You were very good today. Now I understand that there is no Sunday school today, so it's just the nursery, so you might want to go back to. That's up to your parents. Important part in all four of the resurrection stories. And I encourage you this afternoon sometime to just sit down and read the resurrection stories in each of the four Gospels and see where the women appear. So clearly this was a very important part of the understanding of the resurrection to the early church. I am reading from my own translation this morning. It is on the orange insert in your bulletin. Let us pray. Lord God, we ask now that by your Holy Spirit, these words will be more than just words upon a page, but they will be living words, words of life for us and all your people. And so may the words of my mouth and the meditations of all our hearts be acceptable in your sight, Lord God, our rock and our Redeemer. Listen now for the word of God. On the first day of the week, at deep dawn, those same women and some others with them came to the tomb bringing the aromatics they had prepared. They found the stone rolled away from the tomb. Having entered, they did not find the body of the Lord Jesus. And it came to pass, while they were at a loss to explain this, behold, two men stood beside them, their clothes flashing like lightning. The women were filled with fear and bowed their faces to the ground. The men said to them,
"Why are you seeking the living one among the dead? He is not here. He is risen. Remember how he spoke to you while still in Galilee, saying, 'It is necessary for the Son of Man to be delivered up into the hands of sinful men and to be crucified, and the third day to arise.'"
Then they remembered his words. Having returned from the tomb, they related all these things to the 11 and the rest. It was Mary of Magdala and Joanna, and Mary of James and the rest of them who told the apostles these things. But these words seemed to them just idle nonsense, and they did not believe them. But Peter, rising up, ran to the tomb, and, having stooped down, saw the linen clothes lying by themselves. He went away by himself, amazed and wondering what had happened. My sisters and brothers, this is the word of the Lord for us this day. Thanks be to God.
Thank you.
schedule choir right before sermon. Extremely intimidating. And note to parents, maybe next year a little less sugar before a children's sermon. But just something to consider. Well, here we are, Easter Sunday, the holiest day of our year. And we have this text that I read for you. Is it kind of flat, that text? Do you read it and say, well, what happens? You know, it sort of leaves us hanging, doesn't it? Kind of flat. Well, really, I think it's not. In fact, I'm sure it is a story of power. It is a story that has power to change, to reorient our living. If we will look at it just a little more closely, and I think especially if we look at it in terms of the central characters of the story, and those are the women. So these women have done what is customarily, culturally appropriate for them. Okay, it is the first day that they have been able to go and dress the body, if you will, for burial. And so they have these aromatics, these spices that they have prepared. The idea is that they would put them on the body, wrap the body in the linen sheet. Okay? And they get to the tomb. The stone's been rolled away. And they go in, and there's no body. And there's no body there. And suddenly, they are in the presence of these two angelic creatures. And we know that they are angelic creatures because their clothes are flashing. They're like lightning. That's how bright their clothes are. That's the point. Their clothes are so bright, it's like lightning flashing around them. And that's how we know that these are angelic beings. And the two angels say to them, "Why are you looking for the living one among the dead?" Now, most of your translations, and if you are following along in your pew Bible, you know, most of your translations will read, "Why are you looking for the living among the dead?" Which sounds like it could be several living, right? The Greek noun is actually in the singular. It is just one living one. So why are you looking for this living one individual? Why are you looking for the living one among the dead? And what do they say? "He is not here. He is risen." And of course, this is the turning point in the story, isn't it? This is the great switch where the angels declare that Jesus is no longer to be found among the dead, that he is no longer among those who are dead, but he is out there among the resurrection. He is out there living the resurrection life. The women understand that they will not find a body in the tomb, that what they will find is out there. They have to go and look for it out in the resurrection life. And I think Donna Baxter's bulletin cover captures that wonderfully for us this morning. If you want to just look at that, I could really just sort of hold up the bulletin cover and then sit down, because it captures everything that we need to know this morning. I asked Donna, I said, "Donna, I want an empty tomb." And I was expecting, right? I was expecting the standard picture of, you know, here's a hillside, here's a stone that's been rolled away, this dark center in the middle of the page. But instead, what Donna has done is she has taken us inside the tomb. She has shown us that it is empty. And she has reoriented us to look outwards. Donna has changed our focus from the emptiness of the tomb to the life of the resurrection, to the brave new world of resurrection that is outside of the tomb. And this is the experience the women have. They get it. They understand that their orientation has been wrong. They reorient themselves to being out in the brave new world of resurrection love. And so they run and they tell the disciples. And the disciples don't get it. The disciples simply don't believe them. And I can understand that the disciples don't believe them. I mean, I'm sure they wanted to. Jesus was their friend. They had been with him 3 years. They thought he was the Messiah. I'm sure they wanted to believe. But it was just too strange. They couldn't wrap their heads around it. And so it seemed to them like idle nonsense these women were speaking. Perhaps you've had that experience. When people have dismissed your words of good news as idle nonsense. You invite your friends to come and worship with you, and they politely put you off. You try to stand up for morality in your workplace, and nobody wants to hear you. You try to speak about the issues of our day with care and concern and compassion, and instead you are dismissed. You try to reorient people away from claustrophobic tomb living to brave new world resurrection living. Yet all they will do is consider your tale to be idle nonsense. So what do we do? What do we do with our friends, then? Do we leave them in claustrophobic darkness, bumbling around in this tomb, blind to possibilities, desperately looking for life in the midst of their own dead living? Well, yeah, we can do that, sure, of course. But I have to think, what did the women do? What do you suppose the women did? Did they go home? I mean, why not, eh? Nobody's believing us. Might as well just go home. Why bother? Right? And they could have. But somehow I don't think they did. See, I think they kept talking. I think they kept talking and sharing their stories. I think they kept talking and talking and talking until finally a little bit of light cracked in. I think they kept talking and talking and talking about how Jesus had cured them of this nagging doubt that they would ever be loved. That Jesus had healed this hole in their soul, this gnawing in their guts about whether or not they would ever be good enough or nice enough or smart enough. Jesus brought meaning and purpose into their lives. I think they talked about Jesus reorienting their lives away from death towards the brave new world of eternal love and eternal life. And you see, friends, this is our story. This is what we proclaim. We are the women. We are the women who have been to the tomb, and we have felt that life-changing power. And now we are called to share that. Do you remember the movie The King's Speech? All right, am I in trouble here or not?
Yes.
Okay, I'm in trouble. All right.
No, you remember.
Well, it's too late. It's the only illustration I've got. The King's Speech came out about 10 years ago, starred Helena Bonham Carter and Colin Firth as King George VI, the father of the present Queen Elizabeth. And it's set during the 1930s. Now, King George VI, this is a true story, okay? King George VI suffered from a debilitating speech impediment. He stuttered very badly, he stammered. Like it was practically debilitating for him. The problem is, he's king. You know, and his job as king is to give speeches. I mean, that's what he's called to do. He is called in small groups or by radio broadcast, because remember, this is before television, okay? By the power of his words and the conviction of his voice, he is called to unite people and to change people and to give them direction in life. That's his job. But he can't do it because he's got this horrible speech impediment just holding him back. And then finally, he meets an Australian speech therapist named Lionel Loeb. It's a true story. That was the man's name, Lionel Loeb. And Lionel Loeb helped him to get it under control. And the climactic scene in the movie is when the king has to give a speech right at the start of World War II. He has to speak to the nation, and he has to give them more than just a call to arms. He has to give them hope. He has to give them courage. He has to reorient them away from disaster and orient them towards victory. And in the movie, it's very gripping. I mean, it's a true story. We know how it is. But in the movie, you are hanging on to the edge of your seat for this. And it starts, that scene starts, with the king in a little broadcasting booth, standing up, facing the microphone. And Lionel Loeb, the therapist, is over the corner, and he's counting down on his fingers. And the king steps up, and he begins to speak. And then right away, the camera shifts. And the camera cuts to people listening to the king on the radio. By themselves, in groups, in their homes, at work. They're standing on street corners, listening to the store windows, the stores that are broadcasting this nationwide speech. You see the faces of the people. You know, these are the people who are going to suffer. These are the people who are going to go and be killed and be buried in foreign lands. These are the people who are going to be at home and who are never going to be whole again. And they want something from this. They don't know what it is, but they want something from this man. And the king continues to speak. And we see the faces change. We see the faces begin to grasp onto hope. We begin to see the faces find hope, find a future that has victory and power and peace in it. And it's not a perfect speech. The king makes mistakes. But over the course of that speech, you see it in the faces of the people. They reorient their living. They reorient their living away from self and fear and defeat. And they are looking outward into the light with hope and peace in their lives. This is what we do. This is our calling as Easter people. This is our calling as Easter people. To proclaim good news and to help people reorient their lives away from narrow, crabbed, claustrophobic tomb living, to face out of the tomb, into the light, into the brave new world of resurrection life. Is this a black text? Is this a sort of flat story for Easter morning? I don't think so. No, friends, I think this is a story with power. I think this is a story with strength. This is a story that says that there is hope and power out there, because this is our story. This is our story. Our story of how much God loves us, not just now, but for all time. This is our story. By God's grace, may we tell it well. Amen. As we move into a time of prayer, I do not heard on the news this morning in Sri Lanka, Ceylon, last night, Easter Sunday, there were a number of bombings that went off that seemed to have been widespread and targeted hotels in Colombia and other large cities, but also in also churches. And about, I think, 200 people have presently been reported dead there. Yesterday marked the 20th anniversary of the Columbine shootings. And our prayer is that those days will cease, and that resurrection love possibility will be a reality for more people. Are there others we wish to pray for? Yeah. Others that are on our hearts and minds. I'm going to go here and then back. Yes, ma'am.
Esther Ports moved to rehab at Carmel Manor.
Esther Ports moved to rehab at Carmel Manor yesterday, day before, right? Yeah. Just this weekend, Esther had been ill. I know Thursday she was at St. Elizabeth's here in Fort Thomas, because I saw her there. But yesterday we were at Jane Royce's 90th birthday party, and Esther had already moved over to Carmel Manor, so we would want to keep Esther in our prayers, please. And there were some in the back here. Barb, I believe? Yes, ma'am.
Jane.
We want to remember Jane, our brother Jane Mandiette. Excellent. Well, please give her our best. Let her know that we are thinking and praying for her this Easter day. Thank you. But there was another one back here, I thought. No? There are others. Friends, let us turn to God in prayer, shall we? Let us pray. Our gracious Lord God, once again, we come before you as your children. We come before you seeking assurance and hope, seeking some affirmation that your love extends beyond these few years before we wither like the grass and fade in our time. And so, Lord, we are bold to rejoice on this Easter day that your power is with us, and that your love does indeed extend beyond now, but into all time to come. And so we lift up our sister Esther and our brother Gene, and we ask, Lord, for your blessings on all who suffer and those who care for them. We lift up the people of Sri Lanka and ask that you hold them in the palm of your hand. We grieve with the people of Paris and of France and all art lovers and all Christian brothers and sisters around the world for the destruction of this marvelous cathedral. And we give thanks, God, that you are not confined to a tomb or to a church or to any space, but that you are with us always. We pray, Lord God, for ourselves and for our own nation and our own culture, that we will not be a culture that is simply inured to violence, that we will not calmly mark the anniversaries of mass suffering. Lord, help us to find our way out of that empty tomb living, and help us find a way to live in the brave new world of resurrection love by living in the way our Lord Jesus taught us to pray when he taught us to pray, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Friends, having heard the word of God, I invite you to stand as you are able and join us in affirming what it is we believe, sharing together the words of the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, Creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, God's only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day he rose again. He ascended into heaven. He is seated at the right hand of the Father, and he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Thank you. pressure or concern, because we have been changed. Our lives have been reoriented because we are now people of the brave new world of resurrection love. And we pray that this offering will be used to release others from the claustrophobic tomb of dead living and living as your children. We ask this in the name of the one that you raised and who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. Our closing hymn, Christ is Risen, is in the small Sing the Faith hymnals, number 2115.
And one final note, ladies and gentlemen, as is tradition in our church, we would like to invite anybody who would like to join in the postlude, the holiday chorus. During this hymn, please walk up with the choir and join us in the choir loft. And if we don't get enough people, I'm just going to wait until enough people come up. We have plenty of extra copies. Even if you have no idea how to sing, and you've always just wanted to stand within a choir while they're singing, you are still welcome.
May the Lord God Almighty grant you God's own peace. this day and forevermore. And so let all God's people say, Alleluia! Amen.
Thank you. Sorry.
Okay.